Good afternoon, and welcome to our Get Outdoors PA webinar called Celebrate National Get Outdoors Day with a June event. My name is Samantha Holbert, and I'm contracted with Pennsylvania Recreation and Park Society to be a coordinator for the Get Outdoors PA program. Get Outdoors PA is a partnership of state agencies, statewide and community organizations, and recreation departments, all committed to providing outdoor recreation learning events in the communities they serve. These events are intended to connect people to the outdoors in a meaningful way by offering year-round programs to help promote activities such as hiking, fishing, hunting, camping, and biking. Participants through this session will be muted, but you may ask questions or make comments using the chat function in the lower left-hand corner of your screen throughout the session. And we can provide responses to your questions either during our session or at the end of the session. Links to the recording of this webinar presentation, along with handouts from the session, will be available on the partner portal of the Get Outdoors PA website. We will also provide links in the chat box, so if something is referred to during our conversation, we'll try to post it on the bottom of your screen so you can link to it as well. This webinar has been approved for 0.1 CEUs, or one contact hour, and individuals who have purchased continuing education credit for this webinar must attend this live webinar and take the quiz immediately following the presentation. And the final presentation slide will have a link to the quiz. So now I want to introduce you to our speakers. First of all, we have Kathy Reicher, who is the Mid-Atlantic Policy Associate of the Appalachian Mountain Club in Bethlehem. She has served in the City of Bethlehem on City Council and is working for Clean Water Action. In addition to her work with the AMC, she serves on Bethlehem's Environmental Advisory Committee. And she and her husband, Jason, are active hikers in the Delaware Water Gap and Pocono Mountains. Kathy, you want to say hello?
Yes. Hi. Thank you, Sam. And thanks to everyone who called in. I'm glad to be able to participate today.
That's great. Thanks a lot, Kathy. Our second speaker is Tammy Agason, who's the Program Director for Lancaster County Department of Parks and Recreation. She has more than 20 years of experience in parks and recreation management and administration. As well, she's a certified parks and rec professional and an aquatics facility operator. She enjoys the daily balance of parks administration, environmental education, recreation programming, aquatic operations, and staff supervision and development. So I guess basically you could say she is a jack of all trades. Her spare time revolves around her four adult children and her grandson and her husband, and she's from Mannheim, Pennsylvania. Tammy, you want to say hi?
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the webinar.
Thank you, Tammy. And last we have Aaron Pierce, who is the program coordinator for the Susquehanna Greenway Partnership and will only be with us in Pennsylvania for a little while longer. But after spending 5 years with the Susquehanna Greenway, Aaron has helped this landscape initiative get the word out on new riverside land trails, water trails, parks, conserved areas, and revitalized riverfronts. Besides communications, Aaron has tackled paddling, bicycling, river cleanup events, presentations, photos, and whatever floats her way. She grew up in State College and attended Penn State and has a degree with geography. And she has worked with green belts, growth boundaries, and other land use policies. And she's been able to put her passion to work with the National Geographic Society and the Borough of State College and Clearwater Conservancy. And she is currently located in Ithaca, New York, where she's been having a good time hiking in the gorges. So, Aaron, do you want to say hello?
Hello and welcome, everybody.
So this webinar is intended for current partners of Get Outdoors PA, as well as partners that we will hope you will be, if you're not already, to provide you with tools offering a program in June as part of the National Get Outdoors Day, where we encourage healthy, active, outdoor fun in our communities. Our goals are to provide you with the nuts and bolts of innovative events that have successfully been offered for National Get Outdoors Days in the past. And they will provide hands-on practical suggestions to jumpstart your Get Outdoors PA outdoor recreation programs coming up in June. So we're going to talk very briefly about National Get Outdoors Day. It's always the second Saturday in June. This year it's June 11th, and this is the ninth year that it has been offered. Partners have the opportunity they want to provide the opportunity for American families to experience traditional and non-traditional types of outdoor activities. Prime goals for the day are reaching currently underserved populations and first-time visitors to public lands, as well as reconnecting our youth to the great outdoors. And the pilot effort of this program was launched in June of 2008, building on the success of More Kids in the Woods, Get Outdoors USA, and other similar campaigns that were intended to connect Americans, and especially children, with nature and active lifestyles. The USDA Forest Service and the American Recreation Coalition agreed to lead this nationwide effort, focusing on a single day when people would be inspired and motivated to seek out healthy, active outdoor lives and embrace our parks and our lands and our waters. This year, Get Outdoors PA has selected National Get Outdoors Day as a day that we encourage, as a day of awareness, as we call it, where we'll encourage our partners to celebrate and use as a motive for outdoor programming. And we've chosen these expert speakers to talk about it. So our first speaker is Kathy, and we're going to ask and talk to them a little bit about some model programs that they have run in the past. And so they're going to talk to you about those. And as I said, please remember, if you have questions, you can post them in the chat box in the lower left-hand corner. So Kathy, go ahead.
Thank you, Sam. Appalachian Mountain Club has been involved with Get Outdoors Days for about 3 years now. If folks are not familiar with us, we are primarily an outdoor recreation club. We also do work in conservation and trail planning. Our first day Outdoors Day that we did was in 2014, and we made, I thought, a very good decision in working with a partner. We selected the folks down at Delaware Canal State Park. And we really produced a number of events over 2 days. So it ended up being more of a get outdoors weekend, but we provided a pretty thorough menu of choices for people to participate in. We had a gear demo by L.L. Bean. So we have a local L.L. Bean in Center Valley, not too far from here. And they were happy to come out and demonstrate how you could use some of their products. And that was part of the Intro to Family Camping that we did at Ralph Stover State Park. We got a few families to come out who had not been camping before and who had young children, and really kind of got out there and taught them, you know, how to use the gear and, you know, how to have a fun weekend camping with your family that is not too difficult to pull together. We had a kayaking program on the Delaware Canal. We had a bicycling program on the DNL Trail. And finally, we had a chestnut tree hike at Meriton Wildlife Sanctuary. And that was led by one of ANC's volunteers who was interested in the restoration of chestnut trees after the chestnut tree blight, and was able to introduce people to some of the restoration programs at Meriton Wildlife Sanctuary. So I will move on here to our program we did last year. If 2014 sounded like a lot to coordinate, it was. it was very successful. We had over 90 participants, but we didn't get a lot of we ended up running around probably more than we wanted to. So last year we decided we would focus more on one event that could combine a few different types of activities and also to do it in a more urban area, so we could lower that threshold to participating in outdoor activities for folks who might be new to hiking or kayaking. Again, we partnered with Delaware Canal State Park. They were excellent partners for 2 years in a row. We provided a mix of hiking and paddling. So what we did, if anyone's familiar with the city of Easton, we took a number of urban trails through the city, including the Carl Sterner's Arts Trail, which is a really great resource, and then on the DNL Canal Trail. And we ended up with a paddling opportunity. And a lot of these folks had never been in a kayak before, so that was kind of neat to be able to produce that. And we rounded out the day with another gear demo. This year we worked with we worked with Easton Outdoor Company, and they provided some great content, and they're even a supporter of our local trail network steering committee. We had a little bit less turnout than 2014, but it was proportional to the amount of events that we were producing. We are gearing up for Get Outdoors Day 2016, which is going to be 2 days again, June 4th and 5th. This year we're trying something a little bit different, and we're partnering with the Step Outdoors Lehigh Valley event. This is the second year that we have done the Step Outdoors event, and it's in partnership with Arts Quest. So if people are not familiar with Arts Quest, it's a rather large nonprofit here that puts on Music Fest, if anyone has ever been to Music Fest. Last year they got about 1,500 people each day, so it's sort of enormous. and we'll be there tabling and providing people information about local outdoor recreation opportunities, as well as leading an urban hike that will show off the South Bethlehem Greenway, which you see in the image here, as well as some of the trails at Lehigh University. So again, the focus here is just really, low threshold, not too challenging introduction to trails and recreational opportunities for people right here in the city of Bethlehem. So I'll turn it back to you, Sam.
Okay. Kathy, actually, we have a question.
Sure.
Who provided your kayaks, and did you have to pay to rent them?
No, we did not. we were able to work with DNL Canal State Park. They actually had, I think, about 20 kayaks that they used for their programs, and they were happy to work with us and to lend them to us. So that was another benefit of working with partners.
Okay, that's great. And that's one of the items that we have talked about with the Get Outdoors PA program, is that many of the state parks in Pennsylvania have equipment that can be rented out for programs. So that's something that you should think about or check into, because if you have a state park that's within, relatively close proximity, you might be able to borrow some equipment from them for something like that. So that's just a point to think about. So we'll move on with the Susquehanna project. So Erin, do you want to talk about those events?
Absolutely. Thank you. I'm Erin Pierce with the Susquehanna Greenway Partnership, and our Get Outdoors events are our Sojourn series. So this is a guided paddling, camping, learning extravaganza held along sections of the Susquehanna. The mission of my organization is to make it possible to walk or paddle or bicycle from Rivertown to Rivertown along the river. So this program fits in perfectly with our mission. We do it every year. Unlike Kathy, we had this program already, and we kind of stumbled into Get Outdoors Day, so we thought, let's just register the program we're already doing for a great initiative. So that's kind of the nut and bolts of the Sojourn. We've held these events every day from one day to 7 day programs. This year it's a much shorter program, thankfully. And we host about anywhere from 30 to 50 people on the river with us each day. Some of those folks turn over, so we can have upwards of 70 to 80 unique individuals joining us throughout the week. And it is part of a larger River Sojourn initiative hosted by the organization Power, the Pennsylvania Organization for Watersheds and Rivers. They host sojourns on rivers across the state, so this just happens to be part of the Susquehanna series. So this year, we were so excited. We had designation for River of the Year. So in that regard, we are hosting three sojourns. Like Kathy, we find that partnership is a fabulous way to get things done when you're, you know, booked for time, money, and capacity in your staff. So we have partnered with the Endless Mountains Heritage Region up in the northeastern portion of the state. And we'll be, with them, hosting three unique sojourn events. We're really excited about it. You can hopefully join us or learn more about it on our website. It's going to be a lot of fun. So how to do your own river sojourn or, you know, day on the river for National Get Outdoors Day. The big three that I always want to know are, where is my funding coming from? Like I mentioned, these events are part of a series statewide. So we sign up with the Pennsylvania Organization for Watersheds and Rivers and win a grant to help us do this. So it's $900 a day that you're on the water. That's super helpful for us because we hire local river guides to take our group downriver because I am no paddling expert myself. And it's also really helpful because this umbrella group, Power, then provides us with insurance, which is always kind of the sticky point for a lot of groups looking to do water activities. This insurance really helps us do that. Second kind of important factor to do your own is, of course, the planning. So having, for me, based in Lewisburg, PA, but being all over the river, I need those local people on my planning committee. So these are the people that are going to tell me, you know, where to get the best barbecue for my sojourners or which riverfront campsite is going to be the best place to host us. So those local partners on your committee have been amazing in my experience. And then having a great template, a planning form, a document, we've inherited one from a lot of other groups doing similar events, and this form is awesome. It pretty much lays it out for you and helps you walk through what you might be needing and forgetting. And I'm happy to share that with anybody. Just throw me an email at the end of this, or I can even stick it up on the partner portal, which is a great resource for anybody looking to do these events. And finally, the boots on the ground, or like we like to say, sandals in the water. Who are these people helping you out day of? So for us, it's river guides. That's Jeremy Quant over on the right there. He's one of our river guides. And these guys are just amazing. You know, not only do they know the river and the water and the safety and the dams and all these things, but they also have such skills and such knowledge of the river that they're really kind of an educational program in themselves. So those are the big three. To speak more about insurance and permits, because, you know, having helped a lot of folks do this over the years, these are the issues that always come back to us. So let's talk it out. So the first important one is if you're using a state-owned river or boat launch site, you know, have your folks get a permit, get a sticker. They're not crazy expensive. Slap them on your boat and you're good to go and nobody gets a crazy fine. Secondly, be good river neighbors. So we always tell Fish and Boat Commission, you know, where we're going to be, how many we're going to be, when we think we'll be using these accesses. And that's really helped us kind of avoid major problems day of. Say, for example, we plan on using a public river access and Fish and Boat comes back to tell me like, hey, Erin, you know, that day we're also having a fishing tournament on the river. So maybe stagger our launch time appropriately and we could avoid a lot of craziness on the river. So that's been really helpful for me in the past, just telling people where and when we're going to be. Related to that, alerting your local emergency services of your plans. So we travel through multiple counties sometimes on our sojourns. So for me, it's a matter of writing a nice little letter to that county emergency service a month prior to the event and just saying, here's who we are, here's my cell phone contact information day of, here's kind of a schedule of where we'll be along the river, so that if anything would happen, we're pretty well prepared and we've got a great plan. So those are some tips for planning your own.
That's great, Erin. Thanks so much. We'll move on to Tammy in Lancaster County Events. Go ahead, Tammy.
Hi there. At Lancaster County Parks, we have tried a larger scale Get Outdoors PA event to celebrate National Get Outdoors Day in June of 2014, 2015, and we will again be doing one for 2016 this June 4th. We, in 2014, focused on our environmental center area of Lancaster County Central Park, and we partnered with many local organizations like the Lancaster Hiking Club, the Lancaster Bird Club, Rocks and Minerals Club, some local Boy and Girl Scouts, and we utilized the talents of our staff as well. We had about 250 people attend that event, and event-goers would come to our table, pick up a passport, and visit various stations that we had set up in this area of the park, and as they got their passport stamped, they would then come back for a small prize at the welcome table. The event went very well. It was a lot of work trying to get all of the stations together, and the day of it, it resembled sort of an expo or a wellness type fair, except that it was outdoors, utilizing our campsites and our Mill Creek area and our Environmental Center building and some other locations. In 2015, we wanted to add paddling to our event options, and so we had to move to the other side of Central Park where we had river access to the Conestoga. We partnered with some of the same organizations and added Kinsey's Archery Supply, which is a for-profit provider of archery supplies, and they brought their large blow-up learn to learn archery and some of their staff to assist with that program, and we had a paddle in the park program where we put our canoes in the water and took folks just paddling in the direct area of the Conestoga River. We did not attempt a downriver trip for this program. In 2015, our event was more spread out over a larger area, and I believe that that affected our attendees. I believe people, in trying to find our various locations, just sort of gave up and, you know, maybe went to orienteering or went to paddling and didn't find their way around to the fishing clinic or the casting contest or our stream study or any of those things. So we had about 100 people less in 2015. And in 2016, we are going to be celebrating National Trails Day with the opening of the Northwest River Trail, which runs from Columbia through Marietta. And our Chickies Rock County Park is right in the center of the Northwest River Trail. So we will be partnering with DCNR, the Lancaster County Conservancy, Fish and Boat Commission, some historical organizations like the Marietta Restoration Society, and this event will encompass a large portion of the Northwest River Trail and have stations along the trail focusing on both history and natural history and science, specifically geology of Chickies Rock and a little bit on the stream area, Jones Run, and some of the history of the iron furnace and some other things that are in that area. So we're pretty excited about this, and we are not the main driver for this event. It is actually the Lancaster County Conservancy, so the bulk of the work is on them this year, which makes it a little easier for us, and we are expecting upwards of 1,000 people to attend this event. Throughout the year, we also offer some smaller go days to celebrate and to encourage some of the events that are included with the Get Outdoors PA mission. So we've done a family fishing day, which it focuses just on fishing and fish for free, and we go to another municipal provider, Strasburg Pond, which is close by, and we provide the rods and reels and some bait, and we help families learn to fish together and talk to them a little bit about the regulations in Pennsylvania. We've also done a celebration of Winter Trails Day, and we've explored the winter woods, and we've participated in the Christmas Bird Count for Kids. We have also done some winter orienteering and geocaching events to celebrate Get Outdoors mission, and we have, of course, advertised those on the Get Outdoors PA website. just some photos, some of the kids that participated in the archery lesson, the fishing casting, and we also had the astronomy enthusiasts of Lancaster County come and bring their large telescopes and focus on some daytime astronomy for this program. So, yeah, that's a little bit about what we do here at Lancaster County.
That's great, Tammy. Thank you. Thanks for all the great pictures that you all presented and ideas on programs. So particularly for our smaller partners who maybe have not offered events like this before, and that's really the idea here in having these awareness days that we've talked about in the past, trying to let people know about National Bike Month, National Get Outdoors Day, National Hunting and Fishing Day. These are events that Get Outdoors PA are trying to promote and help you to be able to offer programs. Even if it's a one-hour program, you don't have to do anything large and complicated. So that's what we're trying to demonstrate and help you to do. So how do you folks attract first-time visitors to your event? Erin, we're going to start with you this time.
Yeah, it's the age-old question, right? I broke it down into kind of two ways that we do this, what I consider kind of your basic, old-school, traditional methods. Obviously, that's putting out a press release, so we do that when we open our registration, so that can be a big celebration in the press. We've had great pickup with local papers where we're holding the event, as well as some of the bigger statewide newspapers, and as it's going now, kind of digital news is always a good one. We put it, of course, on our website. We make a website for our event, e-blast to our own constituency. So those are folks that pretty much already know about us but might share it with their friends and family. I hit the radio waves early in the morning with my coffee locally, and that's fun, and it's a great way to just kind of chat about what is sort of a complex event, a multi-day paddling and camping extravaganza. So there's a lot to talk about. Flyers, we use our partners and our committee members in their free time. Get out there and newspaper your town, please, with our flyers. And then involving the community has been a great one. You know, we've had a long-running event, so people in communities where we paddle through see us. This image is a great example of that. This is in Clearfield, in downtown Clearfield. They recently just redid this riverfront, so it looks a little different now. But this was our sojourn going through probably 2013 or 2014, and the town was having an event, so there were already hundreds and thousands of people along the riverfront seeing us and interacting with our event. So that's a great way to get the word out too, just incorporating the communities where you're hosting your event. Secondly, kind of a creative publicity that we've undertaken lately, doing feature stories with media. So we've had a lot of luck partnering with Susquehanna Magazine. Each year they do a photo feature or a small feature article on our Sojourn series. So that's a great way to get that, you know, into reception areas of doctor's offices, and you never know where people might pick up these things and read about your event and want to know more. Listing this event in community calendars. So most communities have digital community calendars. You can post anything from yard sales to, you know, line dancing to our Sojourn event. So I will work with our summer interns and we'll kind of get every community calendar we can think of, as well as posting it on Get Outdoors PA calendar. That's another one that's just easy to do, and you get a lot of outreach with that. Promoting our event on Facebook, we do a little bit of that. We don't have a budget to give Facebook our money and let them promote it, but I have found, you know, with the time that I have, if we kind of work out a little post that has a great visual, a link to our registration, and some exciting text, and then I can slap that on partners' Facebook pages, there's a good chance that they will share it to their timeline and help that get a little reach that way. And then we've been trying to really get children involved in our sojourns, which can be tricky just because of the nature of a multi-day paddling trip. So we've partnered with YMCAs in the past to kind of get a one-day kids' day paddle thing joining us on the sojourn. So we'll be attempting to continue that, and they've been good partners as well. And my final point, which I hope to convey with these great images, get a professional volunteer photographer. This image and all the images I've been using have been taken by a great paddling friend, Chuck Haupt. He's up in New York State, but he has provided us with just incredible images, rich colors, you know, great content, children, outdoors, wildlife. It's been so worth our time to really create that relationship we have together. And, you know, like I said, we're a small nonprofit. We don't have a lot of money, so we kind of barter and trade. So Chuck comes on our sojourn for free with the knowledge that, you know, the understanding that he'll give us these photos to help us promote the event in the future. So I highly recommend working something out like that for your event because the images will take you far.
That's great, Erin. And that's something that we have found with the Get Outdoors PA Facebook page as well, is that we have liked a couple of amateur professional photographers who do an absolutely beautiful job, and they've been great sources of photography, and they do get the public interested in participating with the programs. So that's really a good point. Tammy, you want to talk about Lancaster attracting first-timers?
Yeah, thanks, Sam. And like Erin and probably most of you, we do not have a budget for advertising and marketing either. So we are doing a lot of cross-promotion with our partners, sharing social media and websites, sharing information on their calendars and in their newsletters, and posting flyers at their location as well. We are doing our typical press releases anywhere and everywhere. And we usually get a nice promotional poster that is donated by a local printer or design firm, and we sort of put those, again, everywhere we can possibly think of. We utilize a lot of online calendar sites, including Get Outdoors PA, local radio stations, and TV stations as well. Social media, as best we can. Again, we don't pay for any social media ads. We typically try to have a video or some good photos in order for it to be shared over and over again. And we also take some flyers and some information to our local visitors bureaus in hope to attract visitors and tourists that may be in the area. Here I've just listed some of our local partners just to give you some ideas on some folks that you may find that would be natural partners for your organization.
Are there any particulars that you want to highlight, Tammy? Any ones that have been really effective or interesting ones that you've been able to find to participate?
I like the fact that Kinsey's, being a for-profit provider, was willing to help us out at no cost to us. They've been really helpful with us, not only on our large Get Outdoor PA, but on smaller scale go days and events as well. And all of the others are like the PA Master Naturalists and the Lancaster Hiking Club and the Scouts. They're all not-for-profit organizations, and they're all like-minded. They all have the same type mission that we do, and all were extremely willing to help us out. So, you know, I'll talk a little bit later about how important it is to get them on board early, but once they're on board, it's a lot of fun working with them, and you know, you learn a lot from others that sort of do the same thing you do in the same area.
The working with a for-profit equipment supply type business like Kinsey's, Archery Supply, did they loan you equipment to use for the event, or how were they a partner?
They loaned us not only equipment but staff. In fact, they brought out this huge blow-up archery target thing, and they had the safe archery supplies, and their staff was also present actually helping the kids with form and function and safety, and so they pretty much did the entire station themselves, which was great.
Yeah, that's great. Well, that's good for others to know or to think about in terms of how to get partners to help. So, Kathy, you want to talk about how you invite first-timers?
Sure. Thanks, Sam. So we did a lot of the same kind of outreach that our other speakers have done. And one of the things that we do is really push via social media. So we do Facebook. We tend to get a lot of leverage out of. And we also have a membership with meetup.com, which is pretty helpful. We list all of our activities on outdoors.org. Meetup, there is a small charge for. I think it's like, I don't know, $20 a year. I could be wrong. But that's something that we pay for, listing our other activities. Aside from that, we don't really have a budget for advertising either. One of the nice things about being a partner with Get Outdoors PA, of course, is that you can list your activities on Get Outdoors PA, so you can get a little bit of mileage out of that. We put out a press release. We also cross-post our listings with our partners so that their constituents are hearing about our events and vice versa. And we did get a lot of new people exposed to AMC who had not been involved previously by doing that. We also put together flyers. So this is the flyer that we put together last year. You can see I took full advantage of the nice logos that Get Outdoors PA has put together. And then you can see Easton Outdoor Company is the outdoor outfitter that came out and did a gear demo for us last year. And also I threw the National Get Outdoors Day logo on there as well.
Great. Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Final question is lessons learned from prior events. What types of lessons have you learned? And maybe some of you can respond. We had another question here about when do you connect with your partners. So if you're planning out half a year in advance or a season in advance, when do you get a hold of your partners? So if any of you can address that question in your presentations, that would be great. So the first one is Tammy. You're going to talk about this.
I am. We have learned, especially for the large events, we start planning early. In fact, we start planning next year's event probably the week after the current year's event. It's extremely important to get a commitment from your outside partners right away, especially with an event celebrating something like National Get Outdoors Day, meaning that it's always the second Saturday in June. So there's many different people trying to plan events to celebrate National Get Outdoors Day on June 11th this year. So your state parks that are close to you may be committed to another organization. The Fish and Boat Commission, the Game Commission, DCNR, they may be committed to another organization by the time you call to get them to commit to your event. And there's only so many of them to go around as well. So we had a little trouble with that starting a little late our first year, and we were unable to get Fish and Boat to commit, and we were unable to get the Game Commission to commit. And, so that was a big loss for us. We didn't have those events. So we learned for following years to start planning as early as possible and to get that commitment from your outside partners right away. Again, on that same note, check with other groups to prevent multiple events on the same day. What are other people in your geographic location doing that's going to compete with what you're trying to do? And, try to go maybe that Sunday, or this year we move to June 4th, which is actually National Trails Day, and it does kind of do double duty celebrating National Get Outdoors Day as well, so that we weren't competing with some local folks who were trying to run events. We're kind of all in this together, and I'd rather us not compete as much as possible. One of our other lessons was to invite a local radio station. If you invite them to attend, they will often come and do a live broadcast, and that brings in people that were maybe not previously planning to attend your event but had nothing to do that day, heard the broadcast on the radio, and then they head on over to the park.
So, Tammy, that wasn't difficult to get them to come out? Amazing.
No, again, you get them early as you list them as one of your partners. And once you're on their calendar, and you have to make it sound really fun to them as well, and, you know, it has to be mutually rewarding for them, too, to get some additional listeners as being part of your event. So the commitment comes early, and then you just follow up often with all of your outside agencies, including the radio station, doing the remote, just kind of monthly or, you know, every few weeks to say, just want to make sure we're on the same page. We have a meeting coming up, a planning meeting, if, you know, want to make sure you're attending. Is there anything we can do for you? So the more you touch base with them, the more you're on their radar, and they don't, quote, unquote, forget about your event or forget that they committed to your event. Something we learned between 2014 and 2015 is not to spread the event out too far, and that means your specific geographic location. You know, Central Park is 544 acres, and although we didn't utilize all of it for our event, we did have it, in my opinion, too spread out, and we did hear from our participants on customer satisfaction surveys that they couldn't find a certain location, even though we thought we had planned good signage and you know, good information on showing them where to go. They felt that it was too spread out. For longer events, especially if you're going to go over the lunch or the dinner hour, provide some type of food service because people will leave to find something to eat and then they won't come back. And so we found that that was an important lesson learned for us. And finally, don't get discouraged if you if your event doesn't work out the way you wanted it to work out. Kind of regroup and try again. You know, there's nothing wrong with trying something a little different or kind of tweaking things a little bit. So try not to get discouraged you know, just reach out to someone else. We're all in the same boat. We're all trying to do the same thing. So there's lots of people out there that would be willing to give you a hand.
That's great, Tammy. Thank you for your suggestions. Kathy?
Sure. Thanks, Sam. A couple of the things that we learned from our first two events, I think I've said it a few times, and I've heard Erin and Tammy say it as well, but partnerships are really important. I think you'll find that when you're planning an event that organizations, especially local parks, state parks are happy to get involved because these are the same goals that they have, getting people outdoors. You want to provide events that are interesting and multifaceted, so that's why I think, you know, last year we did a hike and a kayak paddling on the canal. Is a little bit more interesting to people than maybe just, you know, one or the other. And it invites people to try out something that might be a little bit new to them. And like Tammy said, you really want to focus on one area as much as possible or kind of keep people, you know, focused geographically. Our first event was just a little bit too spread out, and it made it difficult to organize everything. And also you want to provide activities that are easy for beginners and families. You know, the whole point is to introduce people to something new. And so you don't want to make it too overly challenging. So we keep to, you know, short hikes and, you know, paddling activities that are, you know, in safe, still water. You know, another thing that I like to push is considering an urban event, you know, last year and this year. Last year we were in the city of Easton. This year we're going to be in the city of Bethlehem. It's easier for folks to get to. You know, it lowers the thresholds, you know, the challenge of getting outdoors. A lot of folks actually in the city here in South Bethlehem don't have cars. You know, so, you know, you take away that element of having to drive to a trailhead and you just get people outdoors where they are. So that makes it easier, and you get to show off some of the really awesome opportunities right here in the city. and advertise. So I talked a little bit about how we advertised our event, but you know, just really get it out there as much as possible. That's how you're going to reach new people who haven't participated in your organization's events previously.
That's great, Kathy. Outdoors.org, is that a site that is local or?
That's actually Appalachian Mountain Club's trip listing site.
Okay, and is that only available for AMC partners, or is that available for
everybody? Yeah, that's an AMC website. So I guess you could just say to advertise, you know, on your own website.
Okay, all right, good. And finally, Erin.
Yes, I want to address Megan's question before I forget it. So it was, you know, when do we connect with our partners and how far out do we start planning? For our multi-day river camping sojourn trips, again, we're funded through a small grant with the Pennsylvania Organization for Watersheds and Rivers. I believe they opened that grant funding and announced it somewhere around February. So that's kind of when we start, about 5 months out, because we know, you know, did we get funding for this program or not? And then we'll start putting our partners together and then looking at a section of river that we want to cover, since we do a different section each year. Sometimes it depends which river town projects we have kind of coming online. So last year, we opened public river access in the river town of Jersey Shore along the west branch of the Susquehanna. So we knew that that was kind of the geographic area we wanted to cover because we had that big announcement to go public with as well, and a ribbon cutting and all that good stuff. So, you know, we had to be a little strategic about it, but you're always bound by your timelines, and in this case it was our funder. But what else have we learned after doing this for so many years? There's always something new, new stretch of river, new people, constant learning and reevaluation. I've found that programming is such a huge part of our success. So, you know, beyond just paddling down a river each day, the real draw of our event is that you're experiencing the Susquehanna kind of from a behind-the-scenes, unique take, living along it, sweeping along it kind of way. So it's like adult summer camp, really. So the programming that we have, sometimes it's a stewardship event. We'll do a river cleanup one day. Sometimes, like you'll see over on the right there, we will do a tour in a very special river town. So this was in Woolrich, also along the West Branch. We took all of our sojourners through a tour of the Woolrich Woolen Mills, the oldest woolen mills in our country, still operating. So we took everybody through there, and like this guy, he came out purchasing a blanket. So we were thrilled. You know, we're learning, we're showing the history of our very special area, and then there's a little bit of economic stimulus happening for folks along the sojourn. So we were thrilled about that. On the flip side of that, you know, we try not to over-program, which I think is something I've learned as well. Sometimes at the end of a long day, our sojourners just want to sit around the fire and, you know, play some music or make some s'mores and just chill. So finding a good balance between over-programming and just chilling. Secondly, and I think this features in my quiz question, where are you going to skimp on a budget? I have learned that you do not skimp on the food portion of your budget. People aren't really going to care about T-shirts or stickers or the swag at the end of the day. So I found, you know, I can be a little strategic and I can cut there, but I better not ever cut the food budget because it's so important. This is fuel for folks. I've also found that working with caterers, because we cater our whole thing, it's a lot easier than schlepping food around. Caterers sometimes have no idea when really active people need to eat a lot more food than normal people. So we always up our allocations, you know, 15 to 20 to 25%, and that's been a success. Other than that, just really working with that local committee has been such a great secret to success for us. You know, the local folks along the river know the people to contact and know some of the great stories that need to be told along the river.
I want to thank all of our speakers. This is an opportunity now for participants to ask questions. You can chat them in the lower left-hand corner of your screen. You can just click, you can chat the message and then just hit to all, and then we'll all see the questions that were asked. We want you to leave with the idea that you can program for this. Even we planned it the very end of April, so it's a little bit close, but if you don't want to do a program that's really large or detailed, significant, and you want to do something smaller, you still have time to do that. You can take some of the tips that they've talked about. Again, June 11th is National Get Outdoors Day. However, as I believe Tammy mentioned, sometimes it can be hard on that day to get experts from state parks, et cetera, because they're doing their own events. But schedule something around that day. That's perfectly fine. And we can help you with providing certain tools. Don't forget to visit our partner portal on the website. You need your username and password to get into it. Don't forget to visit that portal. We have promotional materials and things in there. The National Get Outdoors Day website is also really helpful, and they have all kinds of resources. They have press releases. They have lots of tools that you can use for your promotions and things. They have a very large database of materials, and there is their website, nationalgetoutdoorsday.org. So don't forget that. We have contact information for the speakers and Emily Gates, who I think that I neglected to talk about at the beginning. She's doing the back end media stuff here for this presentation, so we appreciate her helping with that. She's with PRPS. So there are the speakers' names, email addresses, and a couple of phone numbers again. Additional information, the Get Outdoors PA partner portal is on your screen. We're going to have upcoming webinars on planning an event for National Hunting and Fishing Day. Depending on how much material we have, maybe we would split it into two webinars, or maybe we'll deal with them together. But that's something we're going to be coordinating with the Fish and Boat Commission and the Game Commission. And then probably late in September, we're going to talk about planning a birding event to coincide with the Christmas bird count. And that activity, bird watching, wildlife viewing, has been one of the largest activities in terms of increase in participation out of our surveys with Get Outdoors PA. So those the questionnaires that we sent out to all of you and asked you to complete in early February, we were asking those questions as to what types of activities you have offered programs for and which ones are new to you. That helps us to know where the trends are, and then we can try to relay that information back to our partners who are trying to develop new program ideas. So that's why it's really important when we send those out that you fill them out and provide us with information. But my contact information is on the screen here, as well as info@getoutdoorspa.org, which is our generic email. Of course, our website and the website of National Get Outdoors Day. Don't forget the continuing education credit for any of you who need to get CEUs for this. And last but not least, please help us to continue to improve and provide you with information that's helpful. So take the short quiz afterwards, and a letter of completion will be submitted to you. So any other questions from anyone? I thank you all for participating today on a Friday afternoon. I hope you have a great weekend, that you do something active and outdoors, and we look forward to participating again in the future If any of you are not receiving partner news emailed to you, please email us and let us know or chat your information here on the screen. Also, we ask you to become Pathfinders. Click on the envelope on the front page of our website, and so you'll receive, that's open to the public. Anybody can become a Pathfinder. So we also ask you to do that. And if you aren't a partner, go to our website and check out the information about that, the benefits, et cetera. At this point, we have 133 community partners. So that's tremendous, and we appreciate your support. So have a great rest of your day, everyone. Thanks a lot.